Human Resource Management on BCTV is supported by Herbine HR Consulting.
I've been a member of the Bergstrom chapter for about 6 years. I've had the opportunity to be a regular member as well as serve on the board of directors. Serving on the board of directors has really given me an opportunity to hone my leadership skills. I've attended a leadership conference for the chapter, and I've also reaped the rewards that the chapter has to offer all of its general members, such as monthly updates on legislative issues, hot topics in HR, as well as the networking opportunities that come along with being in the chapter. We have a great community here, and like-minded business people can reach out to each other and ask questions about policies that they're trying to implement or other issues that their companies are having, and they can receive feedback from other businesses in the community to help them along the way. So if you're not already a member of the Bergstrom chapter, I highly encourage you to join.
Good evening and Happy New Year. I'm here, first time officially as your host. And with me, I have my guests, needs no introduction. He's your past host, Bob Orzechowski. And with him, you may recognize a previous host, is Andy Howe. Bob is the COO of the Lancaster Cancer Center. He's a SHRM senior certified professional. And he's been our past historian, again, past host. He's a wealth of knowledge. Andy Howe is an attorney with Dinsmore Law Firm. He's got 34 years of labor law management. He's also been a past president of the Bergstrom organization. I want to thank our underwriter sponsor, Herbine HR Consulting. They're a full-service professional human resources consulting firm. They're out on 2433 Morgantown Road, Suite 100 here in Reading. They can always help you with anything that you need, and we proudly thank them for their sponsorship this year. I also want to say, before we go any further, that everything we say in this program is not legal advice, even though we have a lawyer on the panel. This is the panelists' opinion, are all their own, and it's, you know, not necessarily their employers. Anything like that. You know, I'm employed by Chester County government. Want to get that out of the way. Also, tonight's going to be a little bit of a different program. We get to reflect back and kind of honor Bob and his hosting the program as well as Andy. We're going to look at kind of how the program came into being, as well as the change in HR over these 17, now 18 years. You know, I'm proud that this is the 18th year, 106th episode. So there's a lot of change that's happened. And then really, at the end, these two guys are hopefully gonna walk me down memory lane and share a few good stories because they've done a lot of hosting duties. Before we begin, let me, just reiterate BCTV mission. It's to enhance unity and strength by providing a medium for dialogue, serving as an information source and forum for idea exchange. You can find us online streaming at bctv.org. Also, our programs are hosted on YouTube now. Again, we air second Tuesday of every odd month from 6 to 7 p.m. And with that, let me kind of turn it over and just ask, how did this program kind of come into being,
I mean, the BCTV program itself.
Well, I guess before that even, we should discuss the chapter, but I assume the Bergstrom chapter had something to do with it, and then program came into being.
Well, the SHRM, Society for Human Resource Management, is an international professional organization, and that comes with certain rights and responsibilities and obligations, of course. And it consists of hundreds of affiliated chapters, and there's bylaws, and it's a true organized effort worldwide. and probably have about 250,000 members, and in probably 120 different countries. So, but its headquarters are down in Washington, D.C., and I believe they're about maybe 60 years going strong now. Our chapter was organized and chartered in 1972. And to see where, to get another perspective on where HR is to think back at what was happening in 1972. Average yearly income was $11,800. Gas was 55 cents a gallon. The Reading Area Community College was founded. And Intel invents a single chip processor, first pocket calculator, and the IBM personal computer desktop was still 10 or 11 years away. So in keeping in mind, there was a lot of paper in the world, and there still is, of course. So, and also, women were, at that time, permitted to be in the Boston Marathon in 1972. Did you ever realize they were banned?
I did not. I do know an interesting fact that, you know, over in Switzerland, they got voting rights in certain cantons in the 60s and 70s, and you always think about that as a little backwards.
So, I was, after the military, went to Penn State for an undergraduate, and my first job, due to an internship, was as a personnel director, and worked at that for a year, and then took a position in a aerospace defense contracting company. And that lasted 10 years and took me out to North Jersey, took my MBA out there. And upon our return to Reading in 1986, I had already been in ASPA, the American Society of Personnel Administration, which is what SHRM was called up until about 1980, I think. Maybe they changed to SHRM. And that was a good and appropriate branding methodology, because it did take, personnel was a little stodgy and paper pusher, kind of clerkish, kind of.
Well, that's the traditional idea of, you know, people have set the stereotype of HR as really a paper pusher, you know, make sure the paychecks get out, everything gets signed, you're not breaking any laws.
Right, and that's why they wanted to change, and it was appropriate and welcomed on all quarters. And I joined the local chapter here in 86 when I returned to the Berks County area and was working for then St. Joseph Hospital in a HR capacity. And back then, there were four officers. It was all volunteers. There was no paid management professional like we have these days. As far as membership, if you didn't have HR in your title, you couldn't be a member. And I thought that was kind of silly. So the first time I was able to go up in the ranks of the officers, secretary, treasurer, vice president, president, and then immediate past president. That was, I wanted to do a little research and find out just, well, wait a minute, this can't be. There's so many other,
there's professions.
There's employment agencies, benefit consulting firms. Benefits was getting really complicated at that point in the late 80s. And so I did a survey. I think there were about 65 chapters, affiliated chapters of SHRM in Pennsylvania. And ironically, it was almost split 50-50, where half of them had a very closed membership program, and the other half did allow for entities that, all individuals, no companies were members, that provided support to the HR profession. And of course, the first ones out there that were appropriate for us were attorneys and employment agencies, headhunters, whatever you want to call, temp agencies, whatever you want to call them, which was a very nascent business in and of itself. A few major players, and I think the first one was Kelly. Everybody remembers the Kelly operation. And so.
So is that how attorneys kind of, like yourself, Andy, came into the organization and started joining the membership?
Right. Yeah, it was. I was trying to remember when Bob was saying that, whether I was the first for this chapter, and I don't think so. I think there were one or two other members already, or attorneys. One remembers Fred Hatt. I think he was the first person I met once I joined who was an attorney. I think he had already been there. But I certainly one of the first, and it was rare for an attorney to be part of SHRM. And today, if I say to an attorney, I'm a member of SHRM, oh, great, where? Back then, it was like, excuse me, SHR what? So there's been a definite progression on that. And as we were talking about before we went on air, I ended up being the first officer for this chapter who was an attorney and then president, which I really enjoyed and I thought was a great opportunity. And I was glad that the membership gave me that opportunity, because I do think that all these other constituencies of the HR world have equal stakes. And
well, I was going to get to, you know, the increased benefits. Like, obviously, as, you know, the nature of the work changed and the membership enlarged, kind of the benefits and offerings of the chapter had to grow.
Right.
And I'm assuming necessarily this program was one of those benefits and offerings that grew out of that enlargement of purpose and scale.
Well, the important thing was not only to open up the membership for that, we opened it up for students. And the issue came down with, okay, now they're members, but can they actually hold an office and contribute to the decision making and progress of the organization? Mm-hmm. And that was a whole nother debate that went on. And because naturally there were some people being, it's a very conservative county, as you know, are they gonna upset the status quo, and what's gonna happen with relationships and power plays and whatever? And of course, none of that's happened, and they've all been a blessing. And in fact, many times the general membership was maybe a bit reticent to take on a 4 or 5 year commitment, because I think we're the only chapter in the free and oppressed world that handles officer ascension like we do. You get recruited and voted into a secretary, become the treasurer the next year, the next year become vice president, the next year become president. And then the year after that, you hang around as an immediate past president, because there's reports that SHRM demands to have, and that's that person's responsibility. Plus, they are the chair of a three-person committee to identify the next person that gets elected. So it is quite a commitment, and there's a few of us that have done that thing more than once.
Right. No, we've done a couple cycles.
But it is, I'd say, Bob, that it's the chapter followed the traditional nonprofit structure as far as governance. So in the traditional 501c3, most people in this county, because everybody generously gives their time to the nonprofits, you see that five-year commitment to a board. It's not just, can you come on this year?
Right.
And there's a reason for it, because you need to understand the organization and grow with it. But you're right in that this particular organization, which is nonprofit, but it also is a business-oriented venture, mm-hmm. where a lot of the nonprofits are traditional give back to
the
community.
We have a budget.
Yeah, that you see this kind of commitment, but
right.
I will tell you that it really benefits, because you learn a heck of a lot about the organization and the national, and the, now international, I should say. But it's funny, because when I came onto the board, they said, we've got a problem. The bylaws don't allow you to be on there. So guess who got to amend them?
The lawyer gets to amend the bylaws.
I'll talk to you in a week, and we got that passing now.
Yeah. As an aside, you know, as chapter 179, I've always just been curious if that makes us the 179th chapter overall for SHRM, or if the numbers were assigned randomly.
That would be something that the historian should know.
I should, you know. But
I never gave it a thought. I don't think that they just put it into a computer and the number spits out, hey, you're number 4,005, you know. I don't think it works that way.
Mm. It could be based on region. I mean,
probably, yeah, like Social Security numbers.
Yeah, or
you know.
The National Labor Relations Board has region 4, region 5.
So,
but now we have something to look up after the program.
So what would you say is the relationship then between our chapter, which, you know, provides a lot of benefits, right? If you're a member, you have this tapped resource that you can put questions to. I've obviously been a member of some board discussions where they'll say, hey, can we vet this question out to our entire membership? You'll get responses. That alone is worth, you know, a lot. You know, some of the attorneys in the membership will respond. We get legal updates. But, you know, beyond just that membership, I wanted to explore the role between the chapter and the program. I know you've said initially the chapter sponsored the program before it took on corporate sponsorship. Kind of how is that interplay? Does the chapter and, you know, SHRM processes and policies inform past programs, and for me, future programs, they will. But I kind of wanted to go over that. What was the relationship in the past?
The structure of the organization was through committees. When I first joined it in 86, there were four of us as officers. We met with brown bag lunches because there was really not much of a budget. We didn't pay for speakers. The board met on maybe the first Thursday of the month, whatever it was, for a board meeting, which was easy because there were only four of us, and we had brown bag or something, or somebody paid for breakfast, and planned the next couple of meetings. Then we'd have a monthly meeting where everybody could come in as long as you were a member. I don't believe guests were even allowed back then. Because of the nature of some of the conversations that go on,
right,
you had to be careful who was in the audience. And so we started branching out into more committees. We had a little bit of growth. Today we're at about 175 people. And I think over 90 to 100 are professionally certified now. And we'll get into certification in a moment. But we started with a program committee, and it branched out to now that we have 12 active committees with chairs, co-chairs, and one or two volunteer members within them. And so the groundwork was laid for engagement and to growing the activity of the organization and providing value to members. Members came.
Yeah.
And people came out of the woodwork and became members. And if your audience as a for-profit or not-for-profit entity, if your audience touches on the HR mission, why would you not belong to that organization?
Right,
and it's that, and that's what the bylaws have turned into. Back when there were times, hard times, and there were layoffs in the economy and whatever, it just played all the more to the value of HR to manage these problems. Today, there's tremendous networking opportunities, the likes of which I don't think would have been available without a SHRM organization. And just in 2020, or recently, we had our 50th anniversary. So we were on the cusp of that as well. We've now got cybersecurity issues. We have a website, and we have pages for engagement and DEI. But it was finding ways to reach out and inform the community and provide a valuable service. The agendas over all these 17 years that we had the BCTV program, the agenda was deliberately meant for employees and employers together. If you're a small business owner, you've got the HR responsibility of somebody at East Penn, whether you like it or not, for
right,
the most part. And so we wanted to be able to provide value, make ourselves known to the community, and then when we went to YouTube, of course, we became international. And the idea was, how can we structure the program to not be entertain? The point wasn't to entertain, the point was to inform. And when we had the live programs, when we could have home viewers, there would be people that would call in with questions. Sometimes they were employees that felt their employer was being unfair or unruly or inappropriate in some way or another. So we had a little bit of dialogue there. That opportunity has gone by the wayside with, again, changes in technology and emphasis. But the main purpose of the BCTV program was to coalesce this information, make it available to people to see how the sausage is made.
Right. I mean, I almost see it as an extension of our meetings. I mean, Andy was a recent speaker. It brought to mind a lot of conversations and questions in my head, and even sparked the idea to ask him to come on to this program this evening. Oftentimes, the speakers featured at our meetings will appear in programs, and it's kind of an extension of that conversation that we've had and gets it out there to the community. I almost see it as like a community service in a way.
That's exactly what it is, and right, we are community-minded. We do provide a holiday dinner for the Police Athletic League organization. Now it's Olivet's Boys and Girls Club. We provide an interviewing skilled job bank, job fairs up at Reading High School. I think we've done it already to other schools as well and spoken to them about interviewing techniques. So we are community focused in that sense, of course. And because we are a professional organization, the National Society offers a certification course, which is a very rigorous examination that one can sit for, study and sit for. And if you pass it, I think it's 160 questions in about 170 minutes. So it is challenging, and it's the basic applied skills and knowledge kind of program.
Coming from the Sherman
it's all
National.
Focused on competencies. Speaking of that, recently, you know, we used to have job descriptions end with experience and education requirements, and there were high school and college degrees and whatever. Walmart has pretty much gotten rid of that now. They've gone to competency-based requirements instead of you have to have a college degree. No, you don't.
Can you do this skill?
And I was going to ask Andrew then to give us some what kind of advice for college students. And while he ruminates on that for a moment, the certification program is very robust. It's a great opportunity. It doesn't cost anything. We have certified member facilitators. The thing now is run very competently by Roe, and our pass rate is always in the 90% to 100%, whereas the national pass rate is about 65%.
And those courses cost a lot more.
And so if you want to go to the one of the 4-year institutions out there that's offering this course, you'll pay thousands. And I don't know if it's how much better, if that's the right word for it, but we have all these facilitators from our chapter who are recent test takers themselves, so they're getting real-time information as hot off the press, so to speak. And I think we have somewhere between 90 and 100 certified members out of the 175 that we do have. And of course, being SHRM members, it matters to SHRM how many members you have that are actually members of the national organization as well. You don't need to be that way with our chapter. You can be a local member only at
right,
LLO,
local
which,
affiliate.
Which helps a lot of people because their employers maybe don't want to pay for the membership and for whatever personal reasons there might be out there. We have a scholarship program. If you have some financial stressors that you're in the profession but you can't manage that, it's about a 10 or 12 week course, Thursday nights or whatever, Tuesday nights. And it's been very successful. So,
nice. So Andy, I kind of want to transition and talk about right when you guys kind of started this program, you know, 18 years ago now. What was the landscape like? What were the hot topics, hot questions coming in? You know, what do you kind of remember from back at that time versus how the landscape is today?
I think that I was thinking about when you said, "What is this? How does this program kind of link to a chapter and link to the community?" And one thing that I found interesting doing it all these years, but especially early on, so I'd say from late 2000s and to like mid 2016, 17.
Years now.
For the first 10 or 12 years of the program, there was great interest at the chapter level, and they'd ask, "Hey, when's the next program? And what is it about it?" Because we really enjoy it, because it's 1 hour, and it was back then they replay it 4 or 5 times a month. Now you can stream it, which is, you know, if you have some sort of insomnia issue, you can watch one of my programs, but. But it really was, I was amazed at the number of people that did watch it from the chapter. But in addition, I literally would be walking down the street or coming to a shop and somebody would say, "You were on TV last night." And I said, "Oh, yeah, it's our program." And he goes, "No, it was really interesting. You know, I didn't know this about that." So there was an awareness. And it also struck me how many people would take time to watch BCTV in general, watch other programs, but that's a community tie-in, right? I mean, I don't think you see that in a lot of communities. So when we did this show, it was an extension of our outreach into the community, but also BCTV having another offering, because at that time, and I'm sure now, it was a very vital part of this county. So that was it. But on the legal side, I mean, things are changing from Bob's point. The technology piece of business was changing a lot of how things were done and how quickly they were done and what was impacting it, sort of preceding the virtual world. And then also, with each change in the administration, Washington brings new laws. But there was occasionally you get a new law that comes in, everybody panics, it's a huge law, you know, we're never gonna be able to comply with it. It's every couple of years in HR law. But it seemed to be kind of in that time frame, we're starting to get a lot of new employment laws, and it was really expanding, and it was making the workplace a lot more dynamic and a lot more complex for human resource. So I remember that, and we focused a lot of programs on legal just because there was so much to talk about back then.
I mean, I think increasingly the HR professional, you know, not like a attorney in training, but needs to know a lot of aspects of the law,
right,
and able to do their job effectively and efficiently.
Right.
That's often why we have the legal updates within the chapter, or why we turn to legal advice from you guys, members within the chapter.
Right.
Kind of when we think about that, especially in the program, I just was personally interested in the call-up aspect. You know, that's something that you said had dropped away. You know, do you have a sense that it changed the nature of the program? Before, you were kind of live responding to call-ins, and now it's much more structured with an interview. I mean, we've got a topic right. And a discussion, but you're not getting that, you know, instant, hey, yeah. Change, shift.
Well, I think the biggest change from 30,000 foot is the HR profession, unless you're in it, you don't know much about it unless you know somebody that's either had a good or not so good experience with an HR person as an employee. And so it's come from tactical to strategic. And there was a time when being compliant had not the impact that it certainly has today. There are local in terms of ordinances, state, and of course federal laws, regulations, but compliance with what? With the standards of the profession, compliance with the ethics of the profession. There wasn't much happening with diversity, equity, and inclusion at that point, and today, it's one of our more dynamic committees it's out there. And so we've got cybersecurity, we have compliance in a strategic fashion with privacy issues, and with all the laws that protect GINA, for instance. And then you had the benefit laws come out, which complicated things tremendously and gave rise to the benefits consulting industry, because if you're going to outsource anything, you're going to outsource payroll and benefits. So now suddenly there's all these moving parts, and the velocity of information was changing as well, that the more HR could outsource, the more they could focus on the strategic instead of the tactical. And I think the only thing we always avoided, more because there was more important information at that time, we had 60 days since the last meeting, and so much had happened, and everybody wants shows on compensation, and employee rights and discipline is always, that always got phone calls for us. But if you look back at the list of all the program agendas that we had, there just wasn't time to build into it the union issues, because it would almost immediately turn controversial, and that's not our point, our role. Our role was to, in fact, we joked about it sometimes that we were, it was so good it was boring. Because
yeah.
We were trying to educate people who had no idea of their HR responsibilities in their companies, small business owners. I mean, something like, what, 70% of the Chamber of Commerce is small business, and they don't have HR people. I think the ratio is, if you have 100 employees, that justifies one HR professional. Now, I don't know if that's still valid, but we have a break, and we'll be right back.
Okay.
Hello, my name is Bob Orzechowski, and I have been a local Society of Human Resource Management Chapter 179 member in Berks County since 1986. I can tell you that the value proposition of being a member is tremendous, and if you have any need or know of anyone who can benefit by growing professionally and being a part of a local chapter, that they contact us at the information that's going to be available at the bottom of this presentation. 52 years ago, four forward-looking HR professionals collaborated to form the local chapter that has now grown to over 170 members, and over 100 of them are professionally certified by SHRM. In addition to that, we hold monthly meetings by subject matter experts where you can get certification credits. And we also engage the community through various Olivet's Boys Club, Boys and Girls Club events, employment fairs, and BCTV presentations as well. We also provide for a professional certification through the society. And if you or anyone you know can benefit from this local expertise, I encourage you to participate and reach out to the chapter. Thank you.
Welcome back. Since we explored the benefits of the chapter, I just wanted to say everybody is welcome to join Berks Sherm Chapter 179 if you have that professional interest. We meet the second Tuesday of every month. Right now we're meeting virtually, but normally it's at the Berkshire Country Club. Come by at 7 in the morning. The meetings usually wrap up at 9. Again, guests are welcome. You can always contact and use the information. Just one more update about the program. It also replays Friday at 8 p.m., Saturday at 1 p.m., and Wednesday at 9 a.m. This gives us kind of a good time to shift. Again, a little bit unusual for most of our programs, but I really wanted to get into the good, the bad, and the ugly and kind of talk about memorable moments for you guys or major topics that changed in the HR landscape. And, it'd be more of a platform for you guys to share and educate me how it's changed. I've watched a lot of past programs, especially with some of the callers I was able to find on YouTube. Very interesting. I know during the break we talked about major shifts, 9/11 happening, affordable care coming along, everything that got dumped on an HR professional's lap, especially everybody knows and everybody has experienced COVID these past few years. Believe me, in the HR industry, that created a lot of new laws, new paperwork, new headaches. But really kind of want to open it up for you guys to walk down memory lane, share with me some of the best, some of the worst, and when I say the ugly, it's not really ugly. It's what you want to make of it.
I think from my perspective, picking up where we left off at the break, the live calling aspect was made it a different program. And I'm not going to say bad because I don't think it was any bad, but it made it different. And our agenda was usually a little different because we always made sure we left a little time, but also had something in the program that might spark somebody to pick up the phone and say, excuse me, or that's something you'd help me with. So to Bob's point, sometimes we just have a program on interviewing. How do you interview? Mm-hmm. Or what happens if you get disciplined? Something that simple, which would invite a non-HR person or somebody who's an employee or knows somebody, or an entry level, to Bob's point, person might ask that basic question. Or how many years do I need to keep records? As we evolved, we got more technical with things like the ACA. But that was one aspect. I always enjoyed the live call thing because I always thought it was very interesting, the questions we got, but also who happened to be watching. And I think the program for a while, we had it at different times of night. So we had 6 or 7. I think we had it in the morning one time, and we actually got a call from a guy. And this is one of those stories that it was 10 or 11 o'clock in the morning. Guy calls up, and he clearly had been on third shift, and he forgot to go home. He must have hit a bar on the way. And he was talking about how all the women in his workplace were chasing him, and he thought he was being harassed. And this call went on for like 2 minutes, and we couldn't cut it off because A, he wouldn't stop talking, but B, we were like, this is the most amazing call we've ever had. And per usual, Bob handled it great and just said, oh, sir, that's great, and we'll get back to you. And Andy, what do you want to say? And I'm like, but. So I liked it, the live aspect, but sometimes we wouldn't get a call, sometimes we'd get 5 a program. It just really depended upon the topic, but I think in the end, the transition to it back to taping, because I think we did taping originally and went live. allowed us to get the content out in a more scheduled manner. Sometimes we wouldn't get to the end of the program.
Well, I assume you would cover a lot more topics because, again, you have the live nature. And then this format, you're able to go more in depth.
Right.
So it's, you know, six of one, half a dozen another. You can always say something's good about both styles. Something's bad about both styles.
And then the other thing I was thinking about on the drive up was, as a live program, and again, we're taping, but they want to stay on schedule. I mean, it was live. So if you weren't there, you know, that's a problem. And I know at least in one instance, I got caught coming in. I'm on calling Bob on his cell phone. I'm like, I'm a minute away. And he's like, well, I'm going to be on the set by myself. And we had a guest. So that was always an interesting aspect, was making sure we're there because you're live. And then we had the famous train horn when we were up by the arena up there one time. We started talking, and the train came through, and it was so loud we can hear ourselves.
That's where BCTV was at that point.
Yeah, right next to
shake.
Yeah.
Momentary pause.
Yeah, right.
For train.
But it was just so. But it's great, and you know, it's interesting because it survived a lot of changes in this county and the city, but also in what we do. But it's somebody had told me the first time I did it that this many years later we still have the program. And if Bob and I had done so many shows together, I would have said, you're crazy. But it's been great.
Our 18th year.
Yeah. It's really enjoyable. And somebody's asked me today when I said, I got to go up to Berks County for the show. I said, what show? And he said, why would somebody ever call in on a show like that? And I said, today in this modern world, it's hard to explain. Because after COVID, to your point, everything's online. But back then, it was more of a
interactive
program. Well, and I really think we did provide value and still do to the community. I mean, I definitely got the positive feedback.
Yeah, I think the structure was, and I was on the certification effort out of Sherm when it was still ASPA, and up until a few years ago, basically would be the facilitator for all the programs, and then got the idea to recruit other facilitators to help with that and identify people that might want to take it over time. But the certification materials have such relevant topic, subject matter, that we were able to have a program around interviewing, but that leads into testing and screening and all the, so we're going from the theoretical to the practical in benefits and paid time off or pay for time not worked, and tie that into USERRA. So I will always appreciate it, even when I was not 100% in HR as a program manager or some other entity, but HR is really a cool profession. You can go anywhere in the company, basically, especially if you get to the C-suite. You can pose the really hard questions. You get to, and of course, the one of the first people you call is your attorney who's on retainer to get the outlines of how to act. But it's really a cool profession because you get to see if you're in marketing, if you're in shipping, if you're in manufacturing, you have blinders on in a lot of ways. HR has no blinder. You can pretty much go everywhere, ask anything. And it's the professional growth that you get, I think, by participating with the chapter, with the meetings. You get to see other people out there, different ages, a lot of diversity in the chapter, and how are they handling those very same issues that you have. I don't know if there's, and I was trying to think back on different looking back on these kind of subjects, but we always tried to find that line of sight between what's happening, how to implement it, what's the considerations, because everybody's handbook is different, and you've got to have that foot in each canoe kind of a thing. But there were times when we actually took a team down to Washington. The National Society would arrange for us to speak with one of our elected officials in Washington So we took a van down once, and there were four or five of us, and I'll embarrass Lou McCoy because he was as guilty of it as me. But we parked the car near the Capitol, and all the streets look the same. And we parked the car, we were running late, and we didn't pay attention to where we parked it. And all we knew is we had to get to the Capitol in about 5 minutes. And when the meeting was over and we came out of the and it was late afternoon, it was kind of busy, we just looked at each other when we got to the street corner and said, like, which way do we go? So, you know, we are human. That's one of the good things about being in human resources. You can cop to that plea. So I just think that we saw a 50th anniversary recently, and it was interesting. Chet Mosteller, who was in the chapter longer than me, but had contact with one of the initial officers, and it was really neat to hear them speak as well. It's when we just think about, even if you're not in the C-suite, even if you're in a small company, think of the impact you have on the company's business model. How does that company succeed? Why do they succeed? Where are their weak points? And it's HR that's going to solve those because it's a people problem.
And the topics of this program have generally covered a lot of those questions. And I think employees and employers can benefit greatly from the topics you have.
Yeah, absolutely, because you see it from both sides. And there are two things I want to mention following up from Bob. One is recently a good friend of mine, and worked with him through his companies as he's progressed through the various companies and Berks he works with, senior VP of HR, recently was appointed interim president of a North American company that's internationally owned. And the first person I know who ascended from the HR role into the president role, and we were together recently and attending a Flyers game, and I said, how's it going? And he said, you know, it's interesting because I know all these departments. I know all the people. I know who to reach. I know how they operate because I've been in every department dealing with issues, as opposed to somebody from the outside or somebody who's in one department, one sector of the business. That was fascinating. So he said, it's much different because I already know what the operations are, just what Bob just said. So it's really interesting to hear that. And then I wanted to mention one funny thing about this program, which I think is really interesting, and that is two times I had this program save me. The first was I was coming out of, I might have been this program or something else, and I parked and my meter expired. And the guy was writing me up. And I said, oh, boy, I didn't get here in time. And he turned to me and he said, I'm tearing this up. And it's, you know, I'm a writing authority, sorry. It's years ago, so it doesn't work.
Statute of limitations.
And I said, why are you tearing it up? And he said, because I see you on TV. I said, what? He said, you're the human resource guy. I love your program. He says, I can't write you a ticket. And the guy literally wrote it, tore it up. True story. And then the second was, not so proud, I was at the magistrate with a speeding ticket, and I had my then partner, who knew that he was going to get it fixed, because I was driving a little quickly, and we wanted to get it knocked down, and I was sitting in the back, and just minding my business, was crowded, and he goes up front, and all of a sudden, you hear the judge say, wait, I know this name, where are you? And I stand up, I didn't want to be, you know, and he says, come up here, and I walk up, and he's looking at me, he says, I know who you are, why do you want this? And I said, well, because I was going a little fast, but it was an accident. He said, but I know you. And I said, where? He goes, oh, wait, you're on TV. He said, oh, yeah, sure, I'll fix this for you. Oh, that's a good program. So twice. True story.
I mean, I think that goes to show that no matter what, every single job profession touches on human resources. You can be a company of two, but as soon as you employ anybody other than yourself, you're going to have to wade into the world of human resources. Even if you don't have a professional on staff, you yourself are going to have to learn some of these topics. Mm-hmm. Again, another reason why this program, our chapter, is a great resource for you. I've always kind of looked at this, and the more I've tracked this, you know, if you didn't know, I'm also the chapter historian. So I've been looking back, and I think Bob and other hosts have really done a skillful job of patterning this program not only off of major topics of interest, like they've said, hey, it comes up, people were calling. But as human resources has shifted to a strategic partner and has grown its body of applied skills and knowledge that he referenced, you know, it's changed. It's not the paper pushing organization it once was. Bob's done a really excellent job of matching up programs with that new knowledge. Hey, we're going to go international. Like, that's a big push coming in the early 2000s, late 2000s. We got to have a global mindset. Some of the new topics and terminology I've noticed, I mean, it's not very apparent, you know, as the user, because we want to give you just general knowledge information. But Bob, you've done an excellent job of pairing it up with those latest topics and how the industry has shifted.
If you just read the newspaper every day, you don't have to watch the network news. Just even locally, there's so much happening, and we're talking about real people, their lives and their livelihoods and their careers, and in HR, you've got to have that mix of professional engagement coupled with a clinical view of what you're dealing with, because you can't let your personal bias interfere with doing what the company policy is or the company's ethics are, what the going from the theoretical to the practical, being able to maintain an element of confidentiality and having the highest level of integrity, but at the same time, knowing and having the habit of advance is so critical in this field, because you're not dealing with packages on the assembly line or welding car frames or how we distribute the products. You're dealing with the people that are making it happen and taking away their reasons for failure, which any HR person will tell you they're one of their biggest headaches is an untrained supervisor.
Right. I mean,
and how many problems are created?
Not their job, right, or their company.
Well, they're also the first line of defense in the company when an issue arises from the legal side. For many years, I facilitated a program at the chamber, first level supervision, which is either a whole afternoon or a whole day, where we went over kind of issue spotting for first level. And a lot of first level supervisors ascended from the hourly ranks or from being supervised. And predominantly, and it's true of this show too, you have to take where people are generally thankful because they didn't realize, they didn't know, or didn't understand. And it's there's a lot of intuitiveness to HR, but there's also a lot of aha moments. I really enjoyed doing that, as I enjoy this program, because it can be daunting, you know, especially a lawyer. Oh, I was a lawyer, employment lawyer, and it's all that stuff. It's, to me, there's basics, and then there's second level, and then there's call your lawyer. You don't always have to, you know, sometimes people, it's easy, I'll just call a lawyer. And I said, well, yeah, think through it, but there's a time to call us. But it's complex, man. I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on out there.
Well, yeah. Just think of how it's changing. HR needs to be surfing that wave. They can't let that wave go past them and go into shore and crash. And on so many fronts, we didn't have to worry about or not worry, but we didn't have to respond to remote working before COVID. And we had to retool and reshuffle and re-engineer how the work was done. And if it's one thing American management has done poorly over the years, it's job design. We design jobs in response to product markets, not labor markets. Imagine how cool it would be to show up for work tomorrow and be asked to do something a little bit outside your skill set, but that there was a chance there for some kind of lateral active differentiation, and we don't do that. Here's the job, do you want it or not? And that's gone by the way. When was the first time you remember hearing the word ghosting? It's new. And so we've got, in addition to trying to cover those things, the diversity, equity, inclusion issue has just exploded, and rightfully so. We're back to dealing with people and recognizing their capabilities, even if they don't look like us, sound like us, walk like us. And now on top of that, we've got the technology of privacy and cybersecurity, and we're reading about it every day. Somebody's ID is stolen every 3 seconds. And that doesn't count when the bad guys attack an entire hospital or large company or bank or movie studio and get it all. And HR, again, is right there with the liability protection and
So to, you know, think about that, kind of, you know, it is the new year, you kind of get in that mode of looking ahead, and, you know, I just ask you guys, kind of, if you reflect, and you've already started to do so, what do you think, if you had to prognosticate and say, this is the next big issue to hit the HR office, you know, COVID was kind of our last big one with the remote telework. I think we've got AI, you know, cybersecurity, but Andy, if you go on to prognosticate and say, hey, HR professionals, look out, this will be the next thing coming to your plate.
I think it is going to, it's going to, well, one of the things that's a major push to the country right now, and it's at the federal level, is the whole concept of non-competition. Now, is that as immediate as, say, when the ACA, you know, the Affordability Act came into play? No, but it is impacting business operations nationally, and it's under attack. So that's one thing. But I do think predominantly it's this whole remote work and hybrid remote work. It's a real tiger by the tail, and it's becoming. I said it a couple months ago. I said to somebody, this is going to be the one. And you're starting to see it because people are refusing to come in. There's something I heard the other day called coffee badging, or you come in and get coffee, you swipe your badge, you drink coffee, you walk around, and you slip out the side door and you say, I was there. And that's a thing now. And it's a real problem because you have a lot of brick and mortar. A lot of people have leased big offices and they're trying to decide what to do. Some businesses, you need your people there. Now, manufacturing, you got to be there, at least for now. Yeah. There's a lot of non-manufacturing where you could do it remotely. So I could go on. That's another topic for another show. But I really think that's where it's headed.
So remote work still.
Yeah, and all the offshoot issues that are going to be.
Does the employer have the right to insist you keep your camera on while you're working? And it gets to the privacy issues. What I think you're going to see is, and I don't like the word artificial intelligence. I prefer augmented intelligence. And AI in HR is, we haven't scratched the surface of what that's capable of yet. But to show you how important it is, one of the most prestigious medical journals in the free world is the New England Journal of Medicine. They now created a separate journal for AI in medicine. Separate journal from their regular journal. And so I think HR, and now the newer Microsoft keyboards are coming out with an actual AI key.
To just help you right there.
You go right to it. And we're starting to see that, especially in the field of OSHA compliance and safety. You can establish these protocols in AI that can monitor people's safe working habits. And right away
just
for that.
Just like the auto insurers, you can get a discount if they monitor your driving practices.
Only this, you know, again, we're talking about the whole safety issue.
That's hopefully a safety issue as well.
Right.
Especially the way my brother drives, I'd say it is.
Well,
Force him to slow down.
I do remember the anecdote you told us about one time you were driving and a policeman pulled you over, but your car, you had to turn the car on, and he kept yelling at you, don't turn the car on.
Yeah, yeah. Because there's automatic windows. And he came to the passenger side. My window was up, and he said, lower your window. So I went to turn on my car to power up the window, and he pulled his gun out. I said, don't touch the ignition, lower the window. And I said, I can't. So then I reached over to open the door
22.
To tell him I cannot. And he said, don't reach. And he's got a gun like this. And by the way, that was in Connecticut. He was a trooper, state trooper. He was subsequently reported. But just a word to the wise. If you have an automatic car, lower the window.
Here, you know,
No.
That just popped into my head.
It's true, though. It's true story. And my oldest brother's a retired policeman. And I said to him, you know, this is the craziest thing in the world. And he said, why don't you come around to the driver's side? And I said, I don't know. And he said, and that's when my brother called up there. My brother called up to the barracks and said, I'm kind of interested. My brother, this happened. And so he called and he got the guy and he said, I'm talking about badge 74. And he goes, do you have a complaint also? And my brother said, that's all I needed to know. Anyway. Well, many years ago, back when I was younger and had a lot more energy, now I don't drive fast, as far as anybody knows on the program.
Hey, everything is beyond, you know, legal limitations, statutes, and all that.
We have a sense of humor, too.
Yeah,
I'm not just stiff necks.
Everyone's more.
I do want to say, I've really enjoyed coming onto this program. You know, it's been interesting to, you know, have transitioned. I initially did guest with Bob as a compensation analyst. We had that episode. Agreed to kind of come on. I've looked back at a lot of episodes, and, you know, I think first and foremost we got to say, you know, thank you, Andy, thank you, Bob, for all the contributions you've made. I want to say again, I think I framed this as a community service. I think you guys saw it the same way.
Absolutely.
I kind of hope to continue in that legacy of bringing you information that's topical, major topics that we've hit. Also,
and I think we have to thank the folks behind the behind the booth, because it's the same faces for many years, and they've had to tolerate listening to us year after year about HR. But it's been great because they've been fantastic and really made this show bearable by their production. So I really want to thank them as well.
Knowledge, our partners.
Always enjoyed coming here. It's nice.
John and Joan have been great. Bob, are there any other, you know, past employees of BCTV that you want to recognize? I know you've been hosts for the longest.
It's mostly been John and Joan for just about as long as I think I've been doing
age.
It.
They don't age. I do. I know.
They've been the same. I think we have to keep something like this moving. There's so many legal challenges that if you're in college, and I can't imagine getting too far into the HR profession without a degree anymore, or at least certainly the competencies. The SHRM National Organization does provide for people to have equivalencies in order to sit for the exam, but they're possible to attain that way. But I think the changes that are out there, as Andy was referring to, you constantly have to play whack-a-mole with so many issues, and at the same time be the empath and be the contributor to the C-suite, to the strategic aspects of the business. And there's so much more of a demand today that didn't exist before. And then it's complicated also by...
Before we end, I figure I need to sum up Bob's farewell message. We're about to cut, but I wanted to thank, you know, again, BCTV, SHRM, Herbine HR Consulting. Please message berkschapter179@gmail.com if you're interested in attending, and I'll let Bob have his farewell message. This may be his last episode. Hopefully I'll have him on again, though.
Well, yes, I've just... officially, at the end of last year, I did retire from a chief operating officer position. And even though it was in medicine, it's a business. And because it's a business, there are lots of people with lots of different competencies. And they are in a mission mode, as we all are. But all those 30 years in medical management, I can't see my profession being that much different than somebody who maybe is a manufacturing company or in any other kind of service business, even a nonprofit, as it were. Is that you've got people, there's a structure, and there's a technology being employed. And you have to constantly marry the three of those, and at the center of that Venn diagram is where your decision making has to kind of run to if everything else is gray and open range.
Well, let me say thank you, and hopefully, Bob, you watch it again. Good evening.
Good evening.
See you March 12th.
March 12th.
Human Resource Management on BCTV is supported by Herbine HR Consulting.
Hello, My name is Bob Orzechowski, and I have been a local Society of Human Resource Management Chapter 179 member in Berks County since 1986. I can tell you that the value proposition of being a member is tremendous, and if you have any need or know of anyone who can benefit by growing professionally and being a part of a local chapter, that they contact us at the information that's going to be available at the bottom of this presentation. 52 years ago, four forward-looking HR professionals collaborated to form the local chapter that has now grown to over 170 members, and over 100 of them are professionally certified by SHRM. In addition to that, we hold monthly meetings by subject matter experts where you can get certification credits. And we also engage the community through various Olivet's Boys Club, Boys and Girls Club events, employment fairs, and BCTV presentations as well. We also provide for a professional certification through the society. And if you or anyone you know can benefit from this local expertise, I encourage you to participate and reach out to the chapter. Thank you.